This is a picture of an Lanternfly altissima tree in one of the areas that's been heavily infested with spotted lanternfly for 3 years. We are starting to see tree death in this species, so we don't really know how this is going to have a long-term effect on other timber species, but we are seeing dead trees. I had a video in here, but since we're not connected to the internet, you can search for honeydew raining out of Lanternfly trees on YouTube and you can find it. Sven showed you some footage of that, so I'll skip through some of these. Some of my slides kind of overlap with Sven's a little bit. This is the typical circle of honeydew and sooty mold that you get around trees, and one thing that the other speakers didn't mention is the smell that ensues. So it smells like a really bad fermentation experiment or putrid compost pile. Another unattractive feature of this insect. This is a picture of a resident that has a river birch growing above their deck, and it's Trex decking, which is the plastic, recycled plastic. And you can see the accumulation of sooty mold and honeydew. It makes the decks really slippery, and it's very hard to clean this off of this kind of decking material. So it's another impact of this insect that has cost and safety features associated with it. I'm showing here some of the stinging insects that are collecting the honeydew from the insects, and these properties are just buzzing with stinging insects. So if you have somebody that's allergic in your family, another feature that is not welcome in landscapes. This is a property that had a lot of insects swarming to the houses. So they tend to like to go to tall structures. I've noticed it on silos on farms, houses that have prominent like southern exposures. The insects will swarm to these houses. They like the warmth. The public doesn't understand the difference that this insect isn't trying to get in your house and eat it. So it's not a wood pest. It's also not a pest that will try to overwinter in the walls of your homes like our other invasive insect, the brown marmorated stink bug. But this does cause great concern. So there's an educational need here for people. You see the power cord on this patio. This family is using a shop vac to clean their deck every day. This is a picture of a local church, and I took this picture after 1 hour of accumulation of insects. And they have had increased maintenance costs because, you know, they have events and weddings and things, and they have to pay someone to come in and continually sweep these insects away. This feature of the insect with interacting with buildings has led to some high-pressure sales coming through the area. Certain companies that are going door-to-door canvassing businesses and not really dispensing correct information about potential for damage to structures, and I'm getting calls about that as well. So there's a lot of education needed in this area. Sven showed you this bench already, so I think I'll just skip through, but the point is that if people want to share things or move lawn furniture, there's a lot of potential for it to spread. Firewood is a big concern. A lot of people heat with firewood, the heating season's coming up. Imagine how difficult it is to inspect the firewood that you want to take out of the quarantine area to give to your nephew or something like that. It's just a really big problem and has a lot of potential for it to spread that way. Another area that I have noticed concern about revolves around auctions. We have a lot of auctions in Pennsylvania. This was a family where the patriarch was deceased and they were liquidating a lot of the equipment. And the family did the best they could, but a lot of this equipment was sitting outside in an infested area. And I went there early in the morning and found evidence that the family had tried to scrape egg masses off of these objects. This was a snowplow. And you can see just the imprint of where that destroyed egg mass was. So I was very glad to see that. People are really trying. But if you're in the middle of an auction situation, it's sort of, you know, there's so many other emotions and things going on with a family in this situation. It's just another added pressure on those families. So there are concerns of residents, and I tried to lump them into categories. Certainly, they're concerned about the quality of their life. The picture shows a family that has some pet livestock under trees, and these animals are coated in honeydew and sooty mold. They were sticky and moldy all summer long. People are concerned about the safety. There's a lot of education needed to help people understand that the spotted lanternfly won't bite them, but they're still afraid of them in a lot of cases. But there are a lot of concerns about pesticide safety and a lot of education needed in that area. People are also concerned about pollinator health in relation to pesticide use. Of course, they're concerned about their tree health, and the residents are concerned about agricultural production. I hear that all the time from the people I talk to. They're concerned for their neighbors that are apple producers or vineyards. They're concerned about the costs. I've had people really concerned about their property values, how this might affect that, and the cost of pesticide applications and tree removal. People can't afford that sort of thing in some cases. And then they're concerned about compliance. A lot of people are trying to do the best they can, but they're also concerned that there's a lot of people that are not aware of the quarantine or the insect at all, and that creates tension in the community. I wanted to speak for the green industry just a little bit. That's a commodity group that I do most of my extension work with. This is a picture of a specimen white birch tree in a landscape, and it's covered with thousands of spotted lanternfly egg masses. So this is a specimen tree. These are expensive to replace. People really, you know, are attached to them. And if this tree would succumb to spotted lanternfly damage, it's a personal loss for that family. Landscapers are also asking about potential health effects on trees and the possibility that this insect could spread diseases. We have not observed that, but we noticed this white accumulation around the base of many trees, and we don't really know what that is yet, so it's an area that needs more research, and we have a new graduate student at Penn State that's going to be addressing what are these molds, how might they affect the health of the tree. Could this be a slime flux kind of organism that would discolor the timber? And also the components of the spores that might be being spread, and if that has a potential effect on human health. So these are all other questions. I put a picture of spotted lanternfly on container nursery stock in here just to illustrate that the nurseries are doing the best they can. They're trying to become in compliance with the quarantine or the compliance agreement and the phytosanitary certificates, but it's awfully hard when you have the insects moving around your garden center like this. So the green industry, of course, is concerned about tree health. They're concerned about customer satisfaction. A lot of people are calling green industry professionals looking for tree care, pesticide applications, and we need more research to be able to identify what is a research-based effective recommendation using the least toxic option, so they would be able to satisfy their customers with those available practices. The effect on their businesses, I've had a lot of green industry people say that they're flooded, inundated with phone calls, and they have hired additional staff to try to just continually answer these questions. Some of the green industry businesses have been expanding to provide services for these people. And of course, they're concerned about regulations, the cost of additional inspections that are required, and also about pesticide regulations. So I put this slide together to try to summarize some of the work that Penn State Extension has been doing in 2017. We have two educators, myself and another one, Dr. Amy Corman, who really has been doing most of this work in the southeast part of the state. We've also been training our Master Gardener volunteers and our Master Watershed Steward volunteers, and they've been very helpful with some of the phone call conversations. And we have the front office staff in six counties also thoroughly engaged in this process. So we had over 1,000 phone calls, visits, and emails, and I'm sure that's an underestimate. everybody that's involved with spotted lanternfly knows the phones have been ringing off the hook. These are not short conversations. So if you look in your packets, I've supplied our management calendar and also how to comply with the quarantine requirements. I believe you all should have that. And each phone conversation is basically summarizing Sven's talk and then covering the content in those two fact sheets. These conversations take a long time. So we've had, you know, our volunteers trained up to do that, but we're going to need to have a lot more people staffing the phones across the state. We're delivering displays at events. I counted 39 this year. We've done 30 presentations to 1,335 people. We've had news reports with a lot of the media. They've been very helpful in getting the word out to the public. And I counted the YouTube video hits from our on-demand. We have 10 videos that are up there, and you can see it's over 17,000. And that doesn't include where it's been shared on Facebook pages and also on Penn State's website. So just a specific example of one of these efforts. We had 8 meetings for the public this spring in April. We had 204 people attend. It was a collaborative effort. You can see from Penn State, PDA, and Berks Conservation District. We had 144 people that gave us email addresses, and we surveyed them in October. 50 people returned their surveys. 98% of them said they reported that they taught at least 775 other people. So the public are working on this issue, and they're really reaching out. 52% said they killed spotted lanternfly on their properties. 16 reported that they killed 273 ailanthus trees on their properties, and that's at their own expense. This really does show that the public is trying. 11 trapped trees were established that were reported to me, and I think that's a little bit out of reach for a lot of people, so we need more education, maybe some hands-on kind of workshops to help people do that if they wish. And then I'll just wrap it up with summarizing some of the research side of Penn State that's been going on. We have some dedicated faculty and staff that have been working on projects. We have 2 graduate students. I listed 2 extension educators. Amy Corman and I have been doing some of the research in the field, the applied stuff. And then there's a lot of collaboration going on. So we're looking for efficacy results, research-based recommendations. We're doing DNA analysis to determine where this insect actually came from, the exact location, and that would help us go there and look for beneficial insects that might help us in biocontrol. We mentioned earlier attractants and pheromones and how that might help in trapping them, and then the host range study is also ongoing and important. More of this will be going on. We're always looking for the comments from people to help direct what research can be done. Thank you.
Thank you. This time we have Mary Ann Lieberman, owner of Maple Springs Vineyard, and Calvin Beckman, owner of Beckman Orchards.
Do you want me to roll this? I think it's just going to leak.
Good morning. I really appreciate you all being here. I'm Mary Ann Lieberman. I own Maple Springs Vineyard. Before I start, I want to just say that
Mary Ann Lieberman, Maple Springs Vineyard. Oh, that sounds better. We are at the epicenter of the quarantine. We were identified early on. I want to first of all compliment all of the professionals that you've heard today. Have all been on our property multiple times. We have cooperated for the last 3 years and actually really appreciate being a test site for everything that you've heard about today. Our concern right now is that with the banding of the trees, we are part of the program of treating the bait trees, removing the other trees. on 45 of our 80 acres. We also do that program on our own, spend our own money doing that program. So despite all of our efforts in the vineyard and on the perimeter of the vineyard, I would say 3 years ago, I could take my flip-flop and control things with all of our staff. 2 years ago, I would say we'd have hundreds. This year, despite the best efforts of everybody in this room, we are looking at hundreds of thousands. So we are able to knock these down. So our operation, we have 11 acres under vine. We make about 2,000 cases of wine. We only make our wine with estate-grown grapes. We have about $1.5 million in investment in the vineyard and about $2.5 million investment in our winery. We attract about 4,000 people a year to our vineyard. The challenge within the vineyard is that we have the ability to control the populations, or knock down the populations, I should say, with some products that have been, you know, Erica Snyder's working on them at Penn State and so on, products with like venom. They will knock down hundreds of thousands, and within a week, we have hundreds of thousands back in the vineyard. So I have a lot of concerns about the amount of treatments we have to do to control the population in the vineyard. 2 years ago, my concern was the dew and the dew preventing photosynthesis. It takes six leaves to ripen a bunch of grapes, and those leaves were all glossed with dew. Now, and you saw some of the pictures, and I've provided some takeaways as well, those plants are covered with so many bugs that they're feeding right on the vine. And if we have a difficult winter, I have no idea what the damage is to those trunks at this point. So while I appreciate the view of Mr. Rhodes of treating the perimeter, with the way that these bugs are turning into an absolute infestation at such a rate, I think my goal today is to ask for more resources to address the science of the pest, the insecticides, the bioways, to keep these things in check, to have a lot more science working on predators, potential predators, and to make sure that we are in a bigger way knocking down the core of the population. Calvin?
I appreciate allowing me to come before we hear. Thank you. I operate Beekman Orchards and Vineyards on in Pike Township, Boyertown, Pennsylvania. We farm 127 commercial acres of apples and 70 acres of French vinifera grapes. Like Marianne has reiterated, I've seen from the day one that the first influx when we came into this, we could not really notice much damage. It was very well controllable. Next year, we had a little bit on the perimeters. Our regular commercial sprays and things helped control them. There was concerns that we ran into with customers that I deal with out of state and export about shipment as people started to get wind of this insect. Third year, again, more adults became excessive. PDA came up, spoke to us about their plan to remove and treat ailanthus trees, came out, tug everything. Plan was never implemented. Apparently out of funding is the case, I don't know. This year, it's a totally different story. It's a horror story. Those videos you saw of those things flying in the air was taken at my orchard. They've infiltrated in such large numbers that you cannot stop them. We are in the process right now of harvesting grapes. Excessive feeding on the plants. We've started before the adults came in on some Pinot Noir that went for champagne. I averaged 4.5 ton to the acre we are now harvesting into still wine grapes with the adults. The production has been diminished back to half a ton to a ton to the acre in some instances. There's photos that were forwarded on to you by Farm Bureau that some of these numbers. We've done an insecticide spray in the vineyard. We did an account estimate of 350 insects under every plant. And Sven's numbers earlier, you know, they looked impressive. That's a, in my vineyard alone, that's 2 million of them I killed at one time. These things have economically impacted the grapes the hardest. We are looking at a loss of 215 to 225 tons this year, which is a revenue value of over $400,000. It's also a revenue value to the states and the federal government in tax money of over $90,000. And we're just the beginning. There's damage, again, will these insects do to the plant? Are they going to survive the winter? They have greatly diminished the photosynthesis capacity. They do not have energy to go into the winter as a strong plant to overwinter. The apples have not been quite as bad. They don't seem to feed on the apple itself as they do the grapes. But we are noticing a lot of heavy infestation on terminal end growth, which is the end of the tree that is new, which produces the fruit buds and sets the buds for next year's crops. What the effects will not be known till next year. And the young trees that we are now planting in these new varieties as Honeycrisp, Fuji, and Gala are very hard to grow. It takes a lot of time to get them into the production area. And as these insects feed these, they will stop the growth of the tree and they will never make full maturity. So the impact on the apple side still has not been seen. The other economic side to this is going to be the additional sprays that are incurred. They will average in the neighborhood of 5,000 every application, with possibly 3 to 4. My other concerns come into that there is not a labeled material labeled for lantern fly. We were told to use imidacloprid, carbaryl, and some of the others that are mentioned before you. We need to do something as far as getting a Section 18 and some guidance and direction to where, what can we legally use to keep this open? And the economic portion of shipping to our counterparts. McDonald's is one of my largest customers in Michigan. And this year we had a tough sell to be able to ship apples. We actually had to put them in our controlled atmosphere storage, bring it down if there was any lantern flies that were available or in there, it will kill them. And then we had to ship, but even shipping became a problem just because there's so many of them flying in the air. They'll attach to the trucks, they do whatever. So it's going to affect the trade and commerce. I'm not sure where our exports overseas are going to go as that market is still opening and we're trying to explore these avenues. I think that we need to look for avenues to biologically control these. We have asked for degree day modules. We have done those ourselves. We've done a lot of work to try and combat this, working with chemical companies and things. And we can control our side. It's the infiltration out of the woods and surrounding areas that aren't treated that we can't control. So 2 days later, you're back with the extreme problem. I'm an optimist, and I have to be in my business. And I was optimistic about this insect at first. I have serious concerns at this point, and if it continues, and at this point, I don't know that next year that I will be in business. It is that bad. So I appreciate the time to come before you. The economic impact is going to be greatly impacted to everybody across the board, wineries, etc.
So final comment on somebody who actually puts the grapes in the bottle. We are tracking and have statistics that our nitrogen levels coming into our winery are unprecedented, never seen anywhere in the industry in the world. What the bugs are doing to the plants is coming into the winery, and it's going to be very difficult for a winery to sustain. I get frightened when I go to the gas station and see them all over the walls at the gas station with 18-wheelers and everything else. And I, again, would really ask that with the efforts you guys are making of learning about this, that we get to the business of getting some resources behind the science. Again, we need to know what to spray. There are no harvest intervals. We had to make up our minds on our own. I like to say that I try to be as conservative as possible with all of our sprays, but we're dealing with an infestation, and that puts a lot of responsibility on us. And I really think we need some science behind finding these predators or other methods. I mentioned that we do find that they go to our fans on our Jiffy Lube men, and we saw them up on the phone poles at the transformers. Maybe there's some opportunities to create vibrations that attract them or other scientific experimental things, but we need resources behind it. Again, I think it's going to be difficult if we don't get to the core of the problem to really contain the problem. We did have visitors from Erie come to our vineyard last week. They're very, very concerned about what's coming their way. So again, thank you very much for your time, all the support, and all the support from all the agencies and people that have been focused on this issue.
One other comment I do want to make. There's four commercial growers in our area. I'm here representing them because it's the middle of our harvest season, and I felt it that important to take off today to be before you. And in the 3 years that this has been in our area, none of us have had a person from PDA actually stop in and physically ask us, what's going on in your orchard? What are you seeing? What's happening? And I know they're doing a lot of work, but we're economically impacted. We are in the epicenter. And if you don't ask, you're not going to know the information of what's going on. So it's a concern we have from the growers that information needs to be shared, needs to be out there. Extension's a great way to do that, but if you don't stop and ask, you don't know.
Be happy to answer any questions.
Yeah. Well, thank you all very much. What I have heard in the last hour and a half is very disturbing and very disheartening, I guess you could say. I've been reading about it and talking to Senator Schwank about it, but the impacts of what I've seen and heard here in the last hour and a half is very disturbing to me as far as this goes, and obviously we do need to put a lot more effort into this the best we can, but I'd like to ask the other panelists to sort of kind of come forward if they could, I guess, the best you can around the table here, and then we'll just sort of kind of, anybody has any questions, why we can, we have about a half hour or so to ask questions here, so just limit your questions a little bit so we can get a chance to ask one or two if we can, and I guess we'll start with Senator Schwank and then we'll go from there, so.
Thank you, Elder. We'll wait till everybody gets up here. In terms of questions, you don't even know where to start because there is so much that we need to understand about this. I would like to say, first of all, I appreciate the work that everybody has done on this. The testimony was really important, but probably the most powerful is that comes from the growers, from you, Calvin, and Mary Ann, and what you are experiencing. It's devastating. You can only spray so much. You have days to harvest issues that you've got to deal with. You are on the front lines of this, and it's unfair to make you handle all of this economically on your own without us in some way stepping up to be helpful. That's critically important here. This is something unique. I know Secretary Redding, you mentioned plum pox virus. That was a relatively limited scope in terms of, you know, who may have been impacted by it, although economically important too. I can't think of any industry that's not impacted by this situation. So starting with questions, one of the things that I think will be on everybody's mind, we're learning more about the insect and its biology and, you know, what we can possibly do to control it. We think it has one generation a year. You know, I understand that we've never seen this before and we're learning as we go. I get that. But what are our plans for next year? It seems to me that this has, and especially listening to Calvin and Mary Ann, this has literally exploded in terms of population in the past year. At first, you know, I saw a couple, I'm nowhere impacted as a homeowner the way that you are, but now it's just unreal. Are they coming in on storms, on the tropical storms, in terms of, you know, blowing? Are the populations growing? That have they just outstripped every kind of, you know, method that we've tried to use to control it? Is our leading edge strategy going to work on this? Because we see people that are directly impacted by it now. We can't afford to lose these folks. They're a big part of our economy. It's a bunch of questions. Whoever can start with that, I'd appreciate. I get one thing first, Sven, for you. A lot of these insects that are problems, their populations peak and then they, you know, they collapse. Do you think this is something that will happen with this too? Have we hit a peak, or, you know, what can we expect?
That of course is our fondest hope, but you have to remember when this went to Korea, it did peak after 3 years and collapsed in the fourth season. However, in Korea they do have some parasites and predators and other natural enemies that attack them. It's unclear as to whether or not that will happen here. The DCNR did do a native parasitoid study, and they did find some parasitoids that were released on gypsy moth attacking egg masses at a fairly high rate year two, but found none year three. So that's not encouraging to me. My professional opinion is it will probably collapse at some point. Most populations of insects reach a carrying capacity and do collapse. But you never know. It's an invasive species. It's in a new area. It has access to resources that it didn't have when it went to South Korea or in China.
And we won't be here anymore in 5 years. And if it goes to Erie, it'll be the same cycle. They're going to have the ability to grow in populations, and waiting for collapse will collapse that industry as well. That's the problem with that approach.
What are our plans for next year, Secretary Redding?
Well, you'll get a couple of different answers here, because I think, you know, Matt has shared, I mean, these are real-time conversations that we are in the midst of, I mean, almost by the hour, and we've been working through what do you do based on the 3 years of experience we've had? And the reality is that this year is different than the last, as Calvin and Marianne have shared, and it's different than the year before. At the end of the day, though, borrowing from what we learned from plumpox, is that you need a very aggressive approach. You need a full community involved in it. It is not about what the department or a grower or local governments or anybody else does. It really has to be the full community. There's a lot of research. You could spend all of your dollars right now on different aspects we heard in the last hour and a half of research. The strategy is to expand the field force. That's a discussion about what resources are available. We're going to expand the research topics, the partners in the research. It is about better understanding some of the economic impact that we have. We have an issue with how to remove the trees, how to really be aggressive about the removal and destruction that's also borrowed from plumpox. But I don't want to sit here and tell you that we've got this sort of the alpha and the omega of this strategy. It is an evolving strategy that involves a lot of conversation with USDA and the partners to get there. But it will be aggressive. It will be comprehensive. It'll have to include, I think, more on the community outreach and engagement that we've talked about here with Emily this morning, of that awareness. But even with all of that, this is a major threat, and we don't have a good answer. I don't know, Matt, if you want to share. I mean, you're in the thick of translating, you know, the working group's efforts in the science.
Yeah, as I mentioned in our prepared remarks, you know, we're putting a lot of effort right now into trying to develop a comprehensive strategy and resource requirements that we can communicate through our political leadership in the department to see what's possible. Clearly, the resources, while we've provided fairly substantial resources, depending on the size of the problem that you're looking at, clearly it has not been enough to meet the need. And the methods that we've developed, that together with PDA, really with PDA at the forefront of this, we feel we've got tools that can be effective. But the size, especially with the continued growth of the quarantine, you know, I referenced earlier the idea of this trying to work on that leading edge. I think it's safe to say our goal is not to exclude the high volumes on the inside, but if we don't do a better job controlling the leading edge, it's not going to matter what's going on in the inside, because the inside is going to be the state of Pennsylvania. You know, the rate of spread that we're seeing over time. So we have to find a way to contain it first. And if we can do that and get the resources to do some, you know, perform suppression activities, whether that be through the methods that are established currently in the program, through tree removals, herbicide treatments, pesticide treatments. If we can be effective at using those tools to suppress the populations, you know, as part of our program, and work with growers, homeowners, to really just, again, everyone throwing the kitchen sink at it together, that's our hope, that is the best way to be effective. But we really do feel that if we can't contain it, and it continues to spread, the rate of spread, Sven could probably do a better job than me articulating just how much it spread from where we were last year. But we're looking, I think 2 years ago, we were looking at, we thought maybe 5 kilometers a year or less. And this year we saw 12 from the farthest out point that was known. So it continues to move. And if the population continues to grow as it is, that risk just continues to get exponentially greater.
There is a correlation between sort of the strategy and what we have in terms of available resources. I mean, our request to the USDA is $20 million. In discussions of the last couple of weeks, we think that's probably about half what you need. You're talking about a $40 million commitment. Wow. But we've got to figure out how to do this. And we all understand real-time discussions about what the budget limitations are. But as you hear, I mean, that'll be a loss of, you know, a piece of Berks County alone economically. So that's our discussion. So trying to gear this in a way that gets the field force that we think this is a human capital question, right? It's a question of, you know, the research dollars that are going to be predictable and sustainable over some period of time. It's an outreach strategy that's well beyond, as Emily mentioned, you could drop 10 more people into the conversation today and probably still feel short, mm-hmm. right?
Absolutely.
So those are the things that are in the strategy. Scaling of that strategy becomes part of the conversation in the next couple of weeks. We think the components are right. The question is scale.
Thank you. We can talk again later about this. I'll let my colleagues proceed. Thank you.
We have a number of members that want to ask questions, and next we'll turn to Chairman Pashinsky.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all for your testimony. We have an epidemic, right? So if we were approaching this as a human epidemic, it may provide a little more sense of urgency. And I think that what we want to do is combine the loss of dollars, the loss of your potential businesses, and then the incredible expansion of this disease to other parts of Pennsylvania and beyond. So my first question is, it appears that the commonality that we have between this insect and Pennsylvania is Korea. Have we done anything to begin to inspect whatever products are coming from Korea? Have we established that that is where this insect has come from, right? So, you know, we're continuing to get imports, and what steps are being taken at this point first to take a look at that point of entry? The second thing is, it appears as though you've got a plan, and my word is just we got to accelerate this. This appears to be an emergency. I'm even thinking of the gypsy moth. Now, up in northeastern PA, we've seen countless oak trees decimated because of the gypsy moth. The thing that is most disturbing, however, is there is a spraying technique that can control that. But funds weren't available. So I'm asking all of you to make it very clear what is needed exactly. And then it's going to be up to us to try to help finance it and support your efforts. You're the experts in this field. And that's the comment that I would have to make. What are we doing about the imports? Because that's where it appears we got it. And it appears as though you've got a pretty good plan. You're bringing everybody on board. I'm asking that we accelerate this and we continue the conversation in the sense that it is an emergency. So, thank you.
Do you want to talk about imports or Matt on PPQ?
Certainly we can address the imports. Actually, Dr. Julie Urban with Penn State ran DNA analysis to see where it did actually come from. Korea was ruled out with her first analysis. We do believe it's probably China. The Pennsylvania population is distinct, which means it was one introduction. But immediately in 2014, all of the ports received training. This wasn't something that was on their radar. It's a lantern fly. They don't really cause problems other places. Now it is. They have made interception since. So yes, we have shut off the faucet coming in, and we do watch those very carefully.
I appreciate that. Now, do you have a particular pesticide that can actually destroy this insect?
Many pesticides are extremely effective against this. We're using dinotefuran in our program, but other formulations are also very effective against this insect.
And is there a reason why we're not extensively using that pesticide?
The other pesticides?
No, whatever is most effective at eradicating this infestation.
We have used it up to the maximum label amount that's allowed and even gotten a 24C label, which allows three times the amount per acre.
And it is effective? It's killing the...
Okay. When applied properly, it is.
All right. So then, if there was a large dissemination of this pesticide, would that address the need? And what would be the cost?
You have to couple it with tree removal. You have to remove the host as well.
Again, this is an epidemic. It's an emergency. What has to be done? What is the cost? And what do we need to do to implement? If you have a pesticide that will eradicate them, now it may also cause other residual damage. All right. So you're the experts. So I'm just asking you, what is it going to cost? Because it all comes down to dollars and cents. So,
if I could comment on that, with the gypsy moth, we use a biorational insecticide that is relatively safe for pollinators and people and other things. With the spotted lanternfly, we know the contact insecticides kill them, but it would be a traditional chemical with higher toxicity, and it's really hard to, with gypsy moth, they're feeding on the, you know, you can just dust the trees with these biorational products. When the insects are down on the trunks of the trees, you'd really have to have a high volume application, and it would really have a big impact on our pollinators, and that's the last thing that people are trying to do right now. Along with the public concerns of using that kind of chemistry for those kind of blanket sprays. So that's why PDA is behind the systemic insecticides, which set up the trap trees in a very deliberate use of insecticides. But it's just not as easy as the gypsy moth applications where you can use aerial sprays. that was what we were trying to teach in the program. We had the 8 meetings this spring, and after 204 people listened to us teach them for 2.5 hours, 11 trees were set up by the public. It's just not something that's really within the reach of the general public. Some people can do it with some education behind it, but it's just not as easy as the gypsy moth control strategy, unfortunately.
Yeah, and you're talking about the aerial spraying?
Right.
Yeah, you can't do that, but you have to do it from the trunk spraying. So we need more manpower, is what you're saying, if we could approach it from that.
If we could engage the public in going out and doing those applications on their own, we're trying to do that, but we haven't found a lot of people that have, you know, the ability to do that at this
point. Okay,
and
I don't want to take anybody's time, but I thought it was intriguing about your observation on the transformer, and I think that should be pursued as well. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Representative Maloney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all for being here today. A lot I could say. We wouldn't have enough hours to really touch this from my perspective. This first came to me by Secretary Gregg in 2014, as was mentioned, and some of the things that were alarming to him being an active farmer, but on the other side of the state, wasn't sure where this would go. I, for the first time in the 7 years that I have been here, have had my constituency override the property tax issue by an invasive bug. So that's pretty significant when you know where I come from. And many things that have been mentioned about cost, volunteers, all the things that have already been really reiterated, have been exponential in my office. I'm being text message and email while I sit here from the public who is watching this. My biggest concern has been, from the very beginning, bad communication. Been very involved with things with respect to this, along with all of the other state representatives' duties. And when you don't ask for this type of a thing to happen to us in the Commonwealth, it's pretty alarming when there's so many questions about something that you don't really have the answers to. And so, things that concerned me from the very beginning, I know did get implemented. I'm not so sure to what extent the public really was satisfied with, but I was concerned with the hunting season. I was concerned with trespass. I was concerned with identification of people who were on properties. I was concerned with how do we assimilate this information. We had public hearings and meetings. Been very concerned with the pesticide and the things that has already been mentioned by Representative Pashinsky. I produced an enormous amount of literature at my local fair, at my events, out of my office. These scrape cards, every single one of them times 10 could have been given out that I was given. So I'm glad my colleagues are able to see something that has been going on for quite a while. My neighbors sitting front and center here have been people that I was concerned with would be not only impacted personally, but I think one of the answers and one of the things that I would like to see take place is that our commercial properties must have priority. This is not only their personal investment, but it's the investment of the community and it's the investment of the state with revenue and product. So it seems to me that we must put a priority to properties. I shared with many people here that, look, I'm the epicenter of it. I live right in the middle. All those pictures are either my neighbors, could be my property, could be whatever with respect to where I live. So with the bans, I have heard, and I can't even give you the amount of constituency calls that I've gotten with, we don't get the bans, we don't know how to get a hold of anybody. I've shared this with PDA on several different occasions. I'm not so sure where the communication problem is. You just heard testimony of an individual here who has been impacted in the same concern that I have had. So the communication problem here, I think, is significant. I have people asking me for tax relief. I have people asking me, what about all the money that I have been spending on this pesticide, insecticide, the treatments, the removal of trees, all the things that you have heard in a small sense of testimony today have been front and center for my staff. And look, people can't sit on the patio. They can't walk in the house without having, I had a hunting blind, quite frankly, that looked like somebody sprayed it with glue, with the honeydew. So I saw that 2 years ago already, and know what the impact of this is. Part of getting people jobs, you probably haven't mentioned in any of the details with respect to the part-time help that is seasonal, that is trying to do the boots on the ground work for this. I'm not so sure that it's not a full-time type approach now. The part-time folks, no doubt, are appreciative for that seasonal work, but I think we need to approach this in a much more aggressive manner, as Representative Pyshynski has already said. So I don't want to take more of the time that other representatives who have never seen this before till today would have, but I don't want to be shut out of communication anymore. That happened to me early on in this process. I think it's very inconsiderate to the constituency of Pennsylvania, and especially to my neighbors. And so, very, very concerned with this economic potential, not only to my neighbors, but to where this is going. My wife grew up on an orchard. I still live on that property. And I never identified my property as being one to be treated. I wanted the others to be treated because I felt that that's where the importance was, and wanted to see the help go to those folks. And so as Mr. Rhodes received a text message from his dad, why do you think he would get a text message like that from his dad? Well, you can mold, I can't even repeat the things that I've been told by my constituents. I couldn't even verbally repeat that today. That's how aggressive some of them have taken this concern. So again, many questions about the pesticide and the insecticide issues I do have. I've been told that some of the information that we gave out wasn't maybe what some people agreed to. As you saw today, the Fed and the state, as we refer to it as, don't agree necessarily on how we approach this. I believe they both have tremendous points, and I think that needs to be an effort put together to approach this. So I appreciate it. I know I didn't really give more questions as I did more statement today, but I can't probably reiterate enough what the last 3 years especially has been like living in this epicenter. So thank you.
Thank you, Representative. We're certainly short on time, but we have a number of other members that would like to ask questions. Representative DeLisio, if you could be
it will be very brief and to the point. Chairman, very brief. It centers around communication. Mr. Beekman, I heard what you said when you said no one had visited you, you and Marianne are the epicenter, et cetera. And I just, there's two things. We all deal with constituents. And so it is important to have communication, and you have to feel like you're in the loop. But do you think there is anything that a visit would have added to the database or the information that they already have? And I only say that for one reason, sir, is that resources are limited. They are very finite. If you were here last night, you would have heard that during the budget discussion. So that I am hoping, I don't know for certain, that the department is using its resources in the most productive way, efficiently, but I do want to validate what you said in terms of it is frustrating that you're dealing with this on an hour-by-hour basis. But is there anything that you think the department may have overlooked as a result of not having visited?
Well, my situation here comes into the fact that I have participated in, they have trapping programs on my farm. We have worked with a person with research from Penn State that's doing the program there. The trappings have been going on. I never hear, what do you catch? What numbers do you see? Is the efficacy of what I do in my general maintenance programs taking care of the problem? I do my own scouting programs. Okay? Again, back to, what problems are we seeing? What's happening? If they don't stop and ask us, I am so busy, I do not have the time to track them down because nobody's ever at the office.
So a mechanism to share that type of information as well. Okay, thank you. Thank you, okay. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Representative Klunk.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I'm a state rep in an area that is thankfully right now outside of the infestation zone. However, I represent Southern York County. I neighbor Adams County, have family members who live in Adams County who operate apple orchards. So for me, my question to the panel is, as a state representative outside of this infestation zone, one, what are you doing to educate those folks in neighboring counties like mine to prevent the spread and infestation coming to us? And what can I do and other members here of the committee to help educate our constituents so that it does not come to our local communities? And how can we help you in this fight outside of the infestation zone?
Well, Penn State Extension has had newsletter articles on all of our commodity focused sites and also our home gardener sites. So we're delivering the information that way, but we certainly could use help. Senator Schwank has posted some of our newsletters in her direct mailings to her constituents. We work with townships that put newsletter articles out there. I think our Master Gardener Volunteer Network across the state is going to really be instrumental, and I'm heavily involved in training them on a day-to-day basis. But I'm one person, we have one other extension educator, and we both had full jobs before the Lanternfly came. So the good news is that Penn State Extension will be hiring a new extension associate to hopefully coordinate, you know, the educational message coming out of the college. And that position, I hear, has just been posted today, so we are looking for that individual.
On the private side, I mentioned that we did have the director of the Northeast Pennsylvania Wine Association. We did reach out as a group to invite that person to our farm. We welcome anybody in the state, so if you want to send people over to see what's going on, what we're doing, we are always happy to host people and get the word out.
Yeah, there's a couple of examples. I mean, I think the High Path AI outreach that was done through the House and Senate offices over the last couple of years was extraordinary. Right, it was very effective because it helped us get to the backyard flocks and some of those other issues. So that model exists where information that we produce or extension produces to push that out through newsletters. I mean, I know the monthly radio, TV, social media outreach that's done through the legislature, opportunities for us to partner with you or provide information would be helpful. We've got to get all of the commodity organizations, I think, so your relationship with Farm Bureaus, and growers and others from just on the economic side become a key part of that. And you're all great translators, right? You take all this information and make that sort of accessible both in terms of material but also helping us explain to the larger public what implications are. So any of that you can do would be most important, I think. Amplify what it is that we're doing. Out in the public about implication, because I think we keep bumping into, there's just sort of a level of ignorance around what actually is happening, but also then what is on the cusp of, as we've seen this year, happening. That would be most important.
So then just a quick follow-up question. I know that the tree removal of these trees of heaven is very, very important because that's the host plant for the lanternfly. Would you recommend then in our areas that are outside of the infestation zone to communicate to constituents that please, if you see one of these on your property, to remove it? And if so, how would they properly dispose of it?
We actually have on our webpage guidelines for homeowners that Extension has worked on, and also the document that we have on how to do the tree removal as well as establish trap trees. So that's available on our webpage currently.
It's important to follow the guidelines because, as noted, it's a particularly invasive plant, and if you cut it and you don't take care of it properly, you run the risk of having the same problem pop back up next year, possibly worse than before.
I think Representative Klunk's question, though, is outside of that quarantined area. So if you're in York or Adams, I mean, do you take the, you know, the proactive approach to?
Yeah.
Yes, okay.
I think without a doubt. And okay. And to the your first question, too, on the issue of communication, you know, we've been talking, PDA and USDA, about an update to our plan, more comprehensive accounting of resource requirements. One of the key aspects of this is communication is a challenge because there are so few people who are dedicated, focused on this as a full-time role. And so that's one of the needs that we've taken note of and are trying to address that in developing the plan that we'll present to our leadership. And I'm sure PDA will be, you know, discussing with Secretary Redding otherwise.
Representative Hahn, we have 2 minutes left, so I guess you're last.
Thank you. I'm usually pretty brief anyway. I'm in Northampton County, so I know we had one area, and now I think we have four. But can I assume that it doesn't have to be an agricultural? It could be on my home. So I could be out visiting somewhere in Berks, bring these insects back in my car, and then spread it out. So I think one of the things when we're talking about communication, I do post on my email blast about it, but I'm just assuming in my head farms. But I think now we have to make sure that we're getting out to the general public. So I just wanted to make sure I had that correctly. And are we identifying how they're coming into Northampton County? Do we know if it was someone visiting another area and bringing it in? Is it in wood? Do we know that?
We can't identify the pathway for every introduction into a new area, but there are instances where we have found people visiting hunting clubs with an open bed pickup truck, people with RVs, individual companies that do a lot of traffic between one area and another. So yeah, we do try to track down the pathway as much as possible. There's a lot actually tied to our transit systems, so our rail lines, our major highways. Just because of what you saw when you open your door, it is possible to get 5 to 10 of them in your vehicle, even if you're trying to be careful. And if you're not trying to be careful, you know.
Gas stations need to be treated. I don't know if you could hear it, but we've gotten the call to get back into session. This has probably been one of the most valuable hearings that I participated in. It. When I worked with my fellow chairs to convene this, one of our goals, one of my big goals, was to make sure that my colleagues on the Ag Committee understood what we're facing in Berks County, but what you will be facing in the future if this year's growth in terms of the population of insects continues. We have a huge problem on our hands. We're going to need a lot of resources and continued meetings and, you know, outreach from you in terms of the public, particularly to our commercial growers. Everything, you know, when you're talking about everything from alfalfa to basil, this means every aspect of Pennsylvania agriculture that we can possibly think of. I would ask in consultation with Senator Vogel that we convene again, perhaps in January, to talk about what you've continued to find out. We cannot just say this was nice, we had a hearing, and move on. This is a problem we are going to be dealing with, and we've got to be engaged, both legislators and the folks that we rely on to help deliver the programs that we need and the resources that we need as well. So thank you to all of you. You took the time to come up here to provide us with this information, and we'll continue to reach out to you. Thank you.
You're welcome. And you have
one last quick thing, if I could. I want to thank everybody for the information. It's been informative. And something that Representative Keller, I know, was going to ask for and would help in the talks about communication, legislators' offices can be very helpful in distributing information. So if there's a way for you to provide us some information, some talking points, I guess is what I'm looking for, that we could use to develop this information in a concise manner to actually get out to the constituents, that would be helpful for all of us.
We'll get that to you. And thank you. I think the key in the timing of this also is the strategy is still sort of the draft strategy, right? And real time, but draft, and having the feedback and understanding where, you know, folks have been living this for the last couple of years, you know, right in the center of it. Where can we do a better job? How do we enhance the communication? Where do you, you know, place people if you have them, et cetera, et cetera? And I think that's really been valuable today to say we've got a communication component in the strategy, but it needs to be enhanced, right? And that's both internal and the outreach component of that as well. So thank you all.
Thank you, Secretary Redding. Thank you, the rest of our panelists, for being here today. And we'll thank you very much for your information. We'll convene sometime in the future to discuss this again. Thank you.
Thanks.